If you'd please take your seats, we'll resume our program. I'm going to wait just a little bit. Thank you. For those of you who were here at last year's annual dinner, you remember we unveiled our new brand, but that was just the beginning. Behind the scenes, and with the help of many dedicated friends, we have been preparing for the future of this organization and the future of the humanities in New Hampshire. And here's why it matters.
I don't think there's any other organization in New Hampshire that is really covering the state with free, accessible public programs that bring people together in their local communities for conversations about ideas that matter.
Why does coming home sometimes feel harder than going to war?
The Odyssey, it's 3,000 years old, but it's just as relevant today as it was 3,000 years ago because its war hasn't changed that much.
The Connection program built the confidence in the immigrants. They practice English in the classes in a very informal way so they can relate to their own ideas, start sharing those ideas, then they can build from those ideas to a next level for their own lives.
This year we had the opportunity to work with HYPE, which stands for Hosting Young Philosophy Enthusiasts. What a perfect age to be talking about life's big questions.
A lot of the times we grow up with our parents' ideas in our heads, but soon enough we're gonna be on our own and we're gonna need to start really thinking for ourselves. And I think it's a perfect time to start training kids for that.
I think if we're going to have a successful civil society, we need the work that this organization does.
Hampshire Humanities has, for 40 years, contributed to the richness, the vitality, political and cultural health, and social well-being of this state.
The popularity of this has grown so much that the financial sources have got to expand in order to support the multiple, the hundreds of requests that come in.
This organization, it's rock solid in terms of its current capacity. It has the potential to be twice as powerful, twice as effective, twice as connected to the interests of the people of New Hampshire.
We are in the midst of a $3.2 million capital campaign because we want to be sure that this organization remains strong and healthy in the future, but more importantly, that the programs we're offering continue to be relevant and valued for New Hampshire citizens for the next 40 years and beyond.
The capital campaign will enable the organization to be strengthened. It's going to give the organization a home. It is going to give the organization the means by which they can expand not only the programs, but the context of the programs. They are always on top of the best medium to deliver the message.
We're very excited that we're over two-thirds of the way to our 3.2 million goal. We have a number of very generous supporters who have gotten us to this point to date.
My wife and I are proud to be supporters of the Capital Campaign because we believe in this mission.
And I'm convinced about the quality of its programs.
We're now entering the public phase of the campaign, and we're inviting those who value learning and thoughtful conversation with their neighbors in community to join us.
When people say, why should I contribute to the Capital Campaign for the Humanities? I say, because it's a forever gift. Because you are going to be not only enriched yourself, but you are enriching the fabric of New Hampshire.
Being a leader isn't just about one person, it's about an entire group. So you really need to know how to make sure everyone's ideas are heard.
When they feel that empowered, they can reproduce that in their own families, in their own neighbor, become part of the community.
We will not be able to do all that's there to be done without good people stepping up and saying, I support this mission.
So you've just seen a sampling of the ways that New Hampshire Humanities expands our sense of community, enriches our lives, and enables us to better understand one another and our world. But as Steve said, we have so much more to do. The Campaign for the Humanities will ensure that lifelong learning and thoughtful conversation remain accessible to all for decades to come. Thanks to our early supporters, we've already raised over $2 million toward our $3.2 million goal. And I'd like to ask all those who have contributed to the campaign to date to please stand up, because here's who gets the applause. So now I turn to the rest of you in the room to join these generous folks. It should come as no surprise that there's more information about the campaign and a pledge form and gift envelope in your program book. If the spirit moves you tonight, and I do hope it does, please make a pledge. You can give your envelope to a staff member out at the registration table as you leave. If you'd like to learn more about the campaign and how you might participate, call me. Our society is stronger when everyone is welcomed into the world of ideas. With your help, we will throw open the doors wide and invite Granite Staters to share in the meaningful conversations that spark big ideas and enrich our lives and our communities. Of course, I can tell you all day long about why this work matters, but every year our keynote speakers show us why. We're deeply honored tonight to have Annette Gordon-Reed here. Her research and award-winning books have introduced us to a portrait of life in colonial America long hidden from view. And her work has added to our understanding of the shadow that slavery continues to cast on our nation. As you probably noticed in your program, our keynote speaker has a close connection to Dartmouth College, having earned her undergraduate degree there and now serving as a trustee. I'm so pleased that Provost Carolyn Deaver could be here this evening to introduce her colleague and friend. Besides the Dartmouth connection, the two of them also share a link to Harvard, where Carolyn earned her MA and PhD in English and American Literature and Language. She has been Dartmouth's provost since 2014, bringing more than a decade of leadership experience in higher education administration and academic accomplishment to her new post. Welcome, Carolyn.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you. Thank you, Debbie. I am truly honored to introduce Annette Gordon-Reed tonight. Annette is one of the great public intellectuals of our time. She's a tremendously accomplished historian and legal scholar. Over her many years in our state, Annette has become a daughter of New Hampshire. Though she lives in New York, and she teaches at a pretty good school just down the road, she's a Dartmouth alumna, a Dartmouth trustee, and perhaps most importantly, a Dartmouth parent. Surely there can be no better keynote speaker for an event honoring the humanities than Annette. Throughout her career as a public intellectual, she has made history relevant and accessible to contemporary readers. Annette uses the power of historical perspective to tell familiar stories differently. In doing so, she opens new generative questions about complex topics such as race, gender, sexuality, social organization, power, and human identity. Whether in the classroom or in the boardroom, I know Annette to be a careful, attentive listener and a person with an unerring moral compass. The questions Annette asks, always advancing the conversation, are invariably incisive and often deceptively gentle. I enumerate these qualities to suggest something particular about a person I have come to know and to admire deeply. And I also mean to describe to you a historian's historian, a person who is fully present in her work with a strong point of view, with a story to tell, and with empathy for the human dimensions of the historical narrative. And also a person who works rigorously, who is tirelessly attentive to the telling details that bring a remote story alive in the present. It's this combination of strong voice and methodological rigor that makes Annette Gordon-Reed such a stunningly significant public intellectual. And that's very important today. The issues at the heart of Annette's work have never been more important and germane than they are today. Issues of racial differences and power differentials, gender and sexuality, families writ large and writ small. The accounting of the value of particular lives, rewriting the historical record toward a new inscription of precious lives that matter so, so deeply, but that have not mattered before in stories we tell ourselves about who we are, how we love, and who we intend to be in the future. I'm probably not alone in this room in reading headlines these days with a sense of bewilderment, if not foreboding. These are dark days and violent times in which disinhibition, disrespect, and cruelty are flourishing not under rocks, but out in the bright light of civic, if not civil, discourse. So, if the world ever needed the vision provided by Annette Gordon-Reed, that day is today. If ever the world needed the courageous intelligence, the unflinching skepticism of humanistic thought, as embodied in Annette and her work, and also represented throughout this room, this state, and this nation, that day is today. Annette is, of course, a scholar of incredible distinction, a Pulitzer Prize-winning MacArthur Fellow, a National Humanities Medalist, and much, much more, abundantly recognized as a leading intellectual of her generation. Let us also please welcome a person whose particular voice is urgently needed today, like never before. Annette Gordon-Reed, thank you so very much for joining us tonight.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. It's always nice to be in New Hampshire, where I first came as an 18-year-old from Conroe, Texas, getting used to the idea of winter and sun going down at 4:30. In the wintertime, which is something I never thought was possible, but I learned to love the place, and I love it today. Thank you, Carolyn, for that wonderful introduction. It's strange being up here because I have a co-author for my latest book, and I'm usually going to have somebody next to me to play off a straight. I play the straight man to his comic persona, but I'm here tonight to talk to you about my work. And talk about Thomas Jefferson and the Hemings family that influenced Jefferson's life. There's a historian out west, Virginia Scharf, who asked a question of me the first time I met her. She was writing a book about Jefferson and the women in Jefferson's life, and she said, well, she asked the question, what if everybody in Jefferson's life mattered? What if all the people mattered, not just as props, to sort of set Jefferson up for one idea or another that someone wanted to make about him, some point they wanted to make about his life, but to treat everybody as if they were important human beings, important individuals, that he interacted with, whom he interacted. And so to get a better sense of what Jefferson's life was actually like, because he was dealing with human beings who influenced him. We are who we are, but we are who we are in relationship to other people. And that is what I've tried to do with all of my work in writing about Jefferson. Peter Onuf, my co-author, and I were have been in a conversation about Jefferson for a very, very long time. I met Peter back in the mid-1990s, when I wrote my first book. He was a person who I turned to read my manuscript. He was the Thomas Jefferson Memorial Foundation professor at UVA. And I'd written this book, and I was taking to task historians for the way that they had written about the story about Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings. And I wanted to send it to somebody whom I assumed would be opposed to what I was saying. Now, that was a stereotype, because he was the Thomas Jefferson Memorial Foundation professor, and I thought that he would have the same view as his predecessors had about the story of whether Jefferson had had this long-term liaison with an enslaved woman on his plantation, Sally Hemings. Merrill Peterson, his immediate predecessor, had said, no, that would never happen. The man before him, Duma Malone, the great Jefferson biographer who wrote a 6-volume biography of Jefferson's life, said, no, that would never happen. That was out of Jefferson's character. So I assumed that Peter, following these two men, might have that idea as well. And it turned out he did not have that same attitude. He read the book and he liked it. And he was the one who encouraged the University Press of Virginia, now the University of Virginia Press, to publish the first book, Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings, An American Controversy. And we've been friends ever since then. Having a conversation about Jefferson's ideas, his attitudes about race, his attitudes about politics, just the whole range of things about Jefferson. And we got the idea a couple of years ago when he mentioned that he was about to retire, or I should say I got the idea. I wasn't so keen on the idea of him retiring. You know, when you have people in your life, you want them to stay doing the exact same thing forever and ever, but of course people want to do other stuff. So I said, why don't we write a book together? And we should talk about Jefferson, but we should talk about Jefferson in a way that both of us thought he was not being talked about today. I'm sure you've probably heard the usual thing. Jefferson, the question is asked, well, how could he on one hand do this and on the other hand this and the word hypocrisy? And we thought that that's not a really useful lens for looking at Jefferson, that that was a way of sort of dismissing him as a figure and not thinking about how it was that this particular person came to be the figure that he was, to have the influence that he had over the course of his life. Hypocrisy just, that's a way of dismissing somebody and ending the story. We really wanted to do this thing of looking at him, and as I said, looking at the people around him to try to understand what Jefferson was doing in the world, what he thought he was doing in the world. Not so much what we think he ought to have been doing, because I have a whole laundry list of things that I think that he ought to have been doing, right? It's clear what he ought to have been doing. But, you know, I wasn't alive then, and he would have listened to me anyway if I were. What did this person think he was doing? One of the most important figures in not only American history, but world history. What did he think he was doing? And how did he develop his ideas? So we came up with this idea of writing about him, as we said, from his perspective. What did he think he was doing in the world? Now, this is important because not only was Jefferson a political figure, Jefferson was a figure, one of the most well-known men who owned slaves. He was deeply involved in the system of slavery, even as I mentioned before, he wrote the Declaration of Independence and said, all men are created equal. And looking at these two sides of his life, the good side and the part that's not so good side, suggests that Jefferson in some ways is, you know, he is the embodiment of the sort of the American dilemma. And you can tell a lot about the United States, the development of the United States, and some of the problems we're still having today through looking at his life. So we set out to look at what he wrote. We do have some secondary material in there where we're quoting other people. We mainly quote ourselves. But other than we're not quoting the many books that Peter has written about Jefferson and myself too, we look at Jefferson's letters and try to decide who this person was. The title of the book, Most Blessed of the Patriarchs, we had a sort of a fight about this with our publishers. The marketing people said, that sounds like a religious figure, Most Blessed of the Patriarchs, and you think of, you know, a religious figure, and that's, he was decidedly not that. But we wanted to keep this title, and it's in quotes, because this is what he called himself. This is not us calling him most blessed of the patriarchs. That's how he described himself in a letter to the sister, and I have to say this word. I guess there's no night about the early American Republic where you don't use the word Hamilton these days. The sister-in-law of Alexander Hamilton, Angelica Church, whom Jefferson also knew when she was in Paris, when he was in Paris, he writes to her in 1793, and he has been beaten up by Hamilton in the cabinet. Washington has sided with Hamilton over Jefferson. So he's saying, I'm taking my marbles and I'm going home, essentially. And he writes to her and he talks about how happy he is to be going home. And he said, you know, I'm going to be there with my fields and my farm and my books. And if my daughters join me, I consider myself to be the most blessed of the most blessed of the patriarchs, as blessed as the most blessed of the patriarchs. And we thought, that's sort of an interesting thing, to call yourself a patriarch. There's a letter that he writes a couple of years after that to another man in which he calls himself. He describes himself as living like an antediluvian patriarch. And we thought, all right, a patriarch, you think of a figure of ancient times, but this is the apostle of democracy. This is a person who was the harbinger, seen as the harbinger of the new. There's probably an apocryphal story, but the story gives a sense of how people saw Jefferson, that he ate a tomato on the steps of the courthouse in Williamsburg, because at the time, many people thought tomatoes were poisonous. So by eating, the idea is that he eats this tomato and he shows people that it's not gonna kill you. So that's how people thought of him, as this person who was supposed to be the bringer of new things, new ideas, new ways of governing, citizens governing themselves and so forth, differing attitudes about religion. So how does a person like that call himself something that you think of from the Old Testament? And we set about looking at this, as we said, by looking at his letters, and we determined that every single thing about Jefferson's early life would turn him into this notion of being a patriarch, a person who was supposed to, you know, as a master, have mastery over people. He was, as I said, a slaveholder. He was born in a slaveholding society. He was the first son at a time when first sons, that was a big deal, to be a first son. He was tall, which, you know, made a difference then, and some people say think it makes a difference now. He was well-educated, and he owned other people. Every single thing about him suggested that he was supposed to be the master of things, and he actually believed that from the time that he was a young person. The other thing that influenced him is that he considered himself to be an adherent to the Enlightenment. He read voraciously. He was interested in science, and his view of the world was shaped by his attitude about science, that things would get better and better and better. That's something that's hard to imagine about him, that's hard to accept about his attitude, particularly about slavery, that one of these days it would end, because we, I don't think, are as optimistic about the world, that everything is inevitably going to get better and better and better, because we realize it doesn't go necessarily in this sort of straight line. And he actually thought that it would get better and better. Just as you had more scientific discoveries, you would have scientific government, scientific society, things would change as people knew more. So you have this person born into this structure, this very, very traditional structure, the ones that puts him at the top of the pyramid, but who also saw himself as a questioner of old ideas, a person who was enlightened. And those things sort of clashed sometimes, but they made him different from other members of his society. The question people ask all the time is, well, how could somebody who owned slaves, write the Declaration of Independence and have these ideas? That's total hypocrisy, as I said before, but the real interesting thing is how he came to think that slavery was wrong. Most of his cohort did not. It would have been easy for him to say, this is the way it is, and just sort of go along and not question it, but he actually did. As a young man in his 20s, he wrote in his commonplace book. These are books that people cut out, scrap pieces of things that interest them, and he keeps them there. And he had a poem from a man named William Shenstone that was very critical of the slave trade. The story about the lines about a person ripped from their native land and brought across the ocean to work labor for other people and so forth. So this is a young person who is questioning. This is before he becomes a public figure. Some people said, well, he was just saying those things to impress people. But this is like a private diary that he has before he's even in public office. So he has this idea that something is wrong about this society that he's living in. So we fast forward to him becoming a lawyer. And a colleague of mine, David Koenig, a friend of mine, he's not a formal colleague, but he's also a fellow Jefferson scholar, is going to be publishing a book soon about Jefferson's legal commonplace books and his life as a lawyer representing enslaved people who were suing for freedom, and how he tried in that venue to sort of change the law as he's working as a young lawyer. So this is this sense of this person who is anti-slavery. He becomes a member of the House of Burgesses and tries to introduce legislation that would a gradual emancipation plan, which is totally rejected. And he decides at this point, he just sort of moves back from it. He lets go of it. Even though he continues to write about slavery, about the evils of slavery. So this is the person that we're confronting, that Peter and I are confronting in the book, the patriarch, who is nevertheless a questioning patriarch, who then has a transformation in his life when he becomes a revolutionary. And the thing that is the key to Jefferson's life is his sense of himself as a member of the American Revolutionary generation. The revolution, the American Revolution, is the pivotal, the most important thing in Jefferson's life. We are fixated on slavery, rightly so. We are fixated on race, I think rightly so. Every generation of people asks different questions about the material that we have, the material that we're looking at. He was interested in the American Revolution and the formation of the United States of America. That was his obsession. And once he gets into that role, he thinks about that. He also begins to think about African Americans, enslaved people, in a different way. Before, they are, he would, as his copying out of this poem suggests, victims of a slave trade, victims of a bad system. During the Revolution, enslaved people become dangerous to Jefferson because enslaved people join with the British, as you would imagine they would if people promised you freedom. You had a chance to fight for your freedom. They began to, he saw them as potential warriors, potential people who could kill whites for their freedom. And so they become a dangerous element. Jefferson, as Locke had said, conceived of slavery as a state of war between the master and slave, the continuation of the state of war. You know, most enslaved people were made slaves in war, captives. Slavery is an extension of that war. And he begins to see black and white people in Virginia in those terms, and they become much more of a threat. So then his idea, I should tell you, about emancipation is not just emancipation and blacks remaining in the state, in the United States or America, before it becomes the United States. The idea is that blacks would be emancipated and expatriated. That there was no way for black and white people to live together in harmony. There would always be conflict. Now, this is a point that has caused no end of problem for Jefferson. He writes in Notes on the State of Virginia. He puts out the emancipation plan that he conceived of. And he says, blacks and whites have to be separated because whites would never give over their prejudices against black people. Black people would never forgive whites for what had been done to them in slavery. And he said there could not be any wholesale mixing of the races. Now, this is a point we'll get to later on, but that's his conception in 1782 of what the state of affairs are. So it was this pessimism about, the optimism about the United States and the future of America, but pessimism about the idea of black and white people living together. Now, as I said, this is a sore point, but the truth of the matter is that we have had conflicts since emancipation. It's not as though, if you look at the newspaper today, the news today, as if this has all been, you know, peaches and cream here. This has been a problem. And I think a lot of times people are quite critical of him, and we sort of congratulate ourselves prematurely about having settled all of these matters. They may be settled on paper, but they're not settled completely. So this is his attitude about slavery. Around the time of the Revolution, enslaved people pose a danger to Virginia. There should be emancipation, expatriation, and then black and white people could meet each other as equals, as countries. That's how they would meet, but not mixed together in a multiracial society. So when Jefferson is, after the revolution, after the victory, Jefferson goes to France and as an ambassador, not the ambassador to France, but as a diplomat to France. And France changes his attitude there as well about slavery even further. He takes with him his eldest daughter and a man named James Hemings. James Hemings is the son of Elizabeth Hemings, who was the mistress of a man named John Wales, with whom the two of them, John and Elizabeth, had six children, and James was one of them. The youngest was Sarah Hemings, whose nickname is Sally Hemings. So when Jefferson goes to Paris, he takes James Hemings and his eldest daughter. James is to be brought there to learn how to become a chef in France. Jefferson liked French cooking, and he wanted a French chef, full-fledged French chef at Monticello. And James is there. He apprentices, in some of the best kitchens in France. And while he is there, Jefferson begins the practice that he kept once he came back to the United States of paying enslaved workers. Whenever he's away from Monticello and he's in a city and he's mixing enslaved work with free workers, he pays them all. And he doesn't say why he does this, but if you think about it, it makes for a much easier situation on payday. If some people are getting paid and other people aren't, that's resentment and conflict. Jefferson hated conflict above all else. He did not like conflict at all. So he pays James wages. Before he'd always given James, you know, gratuities and treated James and his brothers differently because if you're working all of this out, if I haven't said it, John Wales was also the father of Jefferson's wife. So James Hemings and Sally Hemings were Jefferson's wife's half-siblings. So there's this strange Virginia family that you have, and they, you know, when Sally comes, they are all sort of constituted there in Paris, in this household. When Sally Hemings does come over, bringing Jefferson's younger daughter, she too is paid wages, and is in a place where they have the opportunity to be free if they wanted to. Because in Paris, anybody who petitioned for freedom, any enslaved person who petitioned for freedom, was granted their freedom. So they could have taken this option, but they don't while they're there. And I think Jefferson paying them, you know, wages, promising them perhaps things, you know, we'll talk about that in a moment, but while he is there with them, he gets a different understanding about slavery because he has these people who are nominally slaves, who are his family. They are the face of slavery to him. He sees himself as a slave owner through these people. The other thing that's happening is that he's looking out at French society and he's seeing a mess. He's there 1784 to 1789. That is pre-revolutionary France. Things are falling apart. People are starving in the streets. There's violence, people cutting people's heads off, even before they really started cutting people's heads out in the 1790s. It's really, really a rough time. And he looks at it and he says, you know, we are a young country, meaning in America. We have a long way to go. These people haven't figured this out. They haven't figured it out. We have a long way to go before we figure out our problems. Between the Hemingses, his sort of weird relationship with them, these people who are slaves but not slaves, And looking at French society, which really frightened Jefferson, not only the violence and so forth, the other thing I should say is Jefferson had very, very traditional attitudes about the family. And this notion of women who were, he said, out in the streets, you know, women messing in politics, doing all those kinds of things, really, really scared him. He said, you know, the sexes have changed business here in this country. Just because women were, you know, he hated Marie Antoinette because she meddled in affairs and so forth. And so politics was a man's business. Men were supposed to run the world and women were in the home. And that was his conception of things. So he's in this place. If you've ever been in a country and you sort of say to yourself, you know, we have our problems, but we're not as bad as this place. That was his attitude about it. So France makes him much more comfortable with his life in Virginia. All these other things that are bothering him about it, overall, he says, you know, we're not so bad. While he's there, Sally Hemings becomes pregnant with his child. Their son, Madison Hemings, talks about this in his recollections. He doesn't say how this happened. Well, how it happened, we know how it happened, you know. Man and woman love, you know. Birds and the bees, all that, but we don't know the nature or the circumstances of what happened here. But Sally Hemings does not want to come back to Virginia because she understands that any child that she has in Paris, in Virginia, I should say, would be enslaved. Virginia followed the Roman notion, partus sequitur ventrum, you are what your mother was. Your status follows your mother. That's not the rule that the English had come over with. You were what your father was. But if you think about the development of the slave system, how it is better, it suits the aims of slavery to make slavery go through the woman as opposed to the man. Men can have many more children than women can have. The sexuality of men was much less under the control of others than women. So you would have a large class of mixed race free people. And they didn't want that. And also, the master, the person who owns the enslaved woman, captures the value of the increase that takes place if the children belong to the mother. I mean, the children follow the status of the mother. She understood that and did not want to have children in Virginia. And Jefferson promised her that if she came back to Virginia with him, because she wanted her to come back, she would have a decent life at Monticello, and their children would be free at 21. They would live with them until they're 21, and then they would go. She buys that, their son says. And you can, when I wrote my first book, I really didn't understand that. I was thinking, you know, why? Madison Hemings said she trusted him implicitly. Now, from our perspective, we say, well, how could she trust him, right? Aside from the fact that she's 16, although 16 is probably not, 16 in the 18th century is not 16 today. We sort of extended childhood to 30, maybe, 35 or whatever. It's sort of expanding. You know, this New York Times article a month ago about a person who was 30 who was going to her pediatrician. I mean, you know, that she'd always had, you know. I mean, there's probably a reason for that, but you know what I mean. It's not the same. So, but she's still young. I was writing the Hemings as a Monticello, and my daughter was 16 at the time. And I'm sort of sitting there typing going, what? You know, this is, but she buys this, and she trusts him. And I was saying, when I was writing the Hemings as a Monticello, it became clear to me, clearer to me, how this could happen, how she could trust him, because he had treated her family, her group of people, very, very differently than the other enslaved people on the mountain. And, you know, she and her sisters did not go to the fields. Her brothers, he let them hire their time out, and lots of times he didn't even know where they were. So she had a different life. And from that is the nearest thing I could say as to why she would trust him to do what he said. He ultimately did do what he said, but she wouldn't have known that. But she came back with him. And their life at Monticello, the life of the Hemings people, the Hemingses at Monticello, really are different, as I said, than other enslaved people. And Jefferson goes completely silent on the question of slavery. I mean, before, he was somebody who was known for talking about the institution and, as I said, talking about the evils of the institution. But once he comes back and settles back at actually goes into politics, but then begins to try to rebuild Monticello, and the Monticello that you see now is not the Monticello that existed before. This is the second Monticello. He concentrates on building the house, and he concentrates on building a life for himself there without thinking about or speaking out about slavery. All of the quotes that we have about Jefferson and slavery after he comes back from France are in responses to questions that have been asked him. He doesn't just sort of volunteer, hey, I was thinking about this, I was thinking about that. People are writing to him to ask him about what he thinks. And he basically repeats. He says, I said all of this in notes in the state of Virginia. I've made my feelings known from the time, back from the 1780s. There's no point in me repeating all of this. But he turns inward on the question. And Peter and I think that, as I said, it's the combination of his experiences in France, his connection to the Hemings family, and the way he sort of sees slavery through the eyes of these particular people that that really, really determines how he views these matters. Now, for the Hemingses, once Jefferson returns, and once this connection to Sally Hemings is there, something strange happens in the 1790s. A number of Sally Hemings's siblings decide that they don't want to be at Monticello. And I talk about this in my first book, that a number of them, either they ask Jefferson to be sold to other people, he frees Robert Hemings and James Hemings, Sally Hemings's two older brothers. Another one is given his freedom, another Hemings, member of the Hemings family is given his freedom. He only frees males. I mean, the only woman that he frees, he doesn't formally free any woman. He informally frees his daughter, Harriet, and Sally Hemings is only informally freed. She just moves into Charlottesville. But in the 1790s, Jefferson frees members of the Hemings family, male members of the Hemings family. And this, too, I think, makes him think of himself as a good master, that term that we sort of balk at. But this is part of the way of hiding from himself, I think, his role as a person who owns other people is by being good to a set of people. The people down the mountain, if you've ever been to Monticello, and they've actually done a good job of restoring a place called Mulberry Row, which is the road outside, right outside the house, where most of members of the Hemings family and other people who worked in the house lived. Those people were the ones who were closer to Jefferson. The people down the mountain or his other farms at Poplar Forest really don't figure in his life in the same way. And I think he closes himself off from that. I mean, he does ride around the farm and so forth, but he's really closed off from those particular people. The Hemings family, as I said, many of them began to leave in the 1790s. The women, Sally Hemings, Elizabeth, and her sisters, remain on the mountain and, as I said, conduct themselves essentially or constructed like white women, not going to the fields, taking care of children, and, not being a part of the rest of the community in the same way. All of this sort of becomes very, very public in 1802. People had been gossiping about Jefferson and Hemings throughout the 1790s. In 1802, a man named James Callender, just after Jefferson has been elected, James Callender was a person who had been a Jefferson supporter but turned on Jefferson when Jefferson became president and did not make him a postmaster, which was a patronage job. He had heard rumors about Sally Hemings, and he printed in a newspaper the story of Jefferson and Hemings, and it caused a huge firestorm of controversy. Although, by the time Jefferson was reelected, time came for him to be reelected, he'd bought Louisiana, and he was enormously popular, and it didn't matter. Sally Hemings and this story didn't matter to people. And he was reelected resoundingly. He didn't have a great second term, but he was remained a popular figure throughout, for the rest of his life, and sort of the head of the Republican Party. There isn't anybody who's had that kind of record since then. He's elected president in 1800, and his successor, Madison and Monroe, were Jeffersonians. There was a break with John Quincy Adams, and then Jackson comes in, and Jackson considers himself to be a Jeffersonian. So to have this person who has this political influence, this long period of time, you know, we really haven't had that happen before. So the Hemings question, even though people tried to make it a problem for him, was always in the background, but never ever rose to really hurt him in any particular way. The Hemingses stay at Monticello. Elizabeth Hemings dies, the matriarch of the family dies in 1807, and the story really shifts. Jefferson's life is really then about, well, Sally Hemings, and also the children that he had with Sally Hemings. Beverly was a male, Harriet, Madison, and Eston. These are all names, you know, these are all named for people who are Jefferson's close friends and favorite relatives. And they have a life at Monticello that's different than their mother and their uncles would have had. Jefferson apprentices his sons to John Hemings, his most, you know, favorite artisan. If you've ever been to Monticello, they have examples of his work as a carpenter. He was a carpenter and a joiner. He did the floors at Monticello and the roof and so forth. Jefferson was a woodworker himself, so he puts his sons under the tutelage of a carpenter, the thing that he liked to do himself, and he spent a lot of time with John Hemings. So when people suggest that he was not like a father to these children, he was a father to these children in the way that an 18th century slaveholder, most of them, could be to their children. That is to say, most of them did not acknowledge their children openly, go down to the courthouse and say, this is my child, or whatever. It was done surreptitiously. The vast majority of them didn't make any connection to their children at all, really. So Jefferson is a bit better in that way, but he was not the best. So he's sort of in the middle of the pack there in the way he handled the children. They do end up being freed, Beverly and Harriet run away in 1822 to live as white people. They are not formally freed. And if you think about it, if you're going to live as a white person, you don't really want freedom papers, because if you have freedom papers, there's a paper trail. And then people could figure out who you are and where you are. And for that reason, we have no idea who their descendants are, because they disappeared into the white world. We know they had children, but those people are untraceable. The two youngest children were freed in Jefferson's will, Madison and Eston, along with two of their uncles and one of their cousins. And in Jefferson's will, he said, he asked the legislature to allow them to remain in the state. The 1806 law had mandated that anybody who was freed had to have permission to remain in the state. If they didn't get permission, they could be sold back into slavery after a year. So he had to ask the legislature to allow them to remain in the state. And he says, and he's sort of explaining why they should be allowed to remain in the state. He said, because this is where their families and their connections are. You remember I said earlier that his plan for emancipation was to say that blacks had to go somewhere else. And this is 1826 when Jefferson dies. By then, Liberia has already been started, and many slaveholders in Virginia are freeing their slaves, not many, not like huge numbers of them, but some slaveholders were freeing their slaves on the condition that they go to Liberia. So he could have said that, but that's not what he says. He says they should remain in Virginia because this is where their families and connections are. And of course, that is the answer to why all black people should have been emancipated and allowed to stay in America, because this is where their families and their connections were. And he knew that, and he understood that. So at the moment of Peter and I writing about this, Jefferson has theoretical ideas about what should happen in the world, but there are practical, realities that he was very, very much attuned to. And he arranges to have these group of men stay in Virginia. Madison and Esten, and Jefferson dies in 1826, July 4th, on the same day as John Adams. Madison and Esten take their mother, Sally Hemings, who at this time is 53 years old, and they move into Charlottesville. In 1830, she is listed as a free white woman on the census, and we don't know how that happened. There's a special census in 1833 that's taken after the Nat Turner Rebellion. They go around and they ask free blacks if they want to go back to Africa. All throughout Virginia, they ask them, and nobody wants to go from that, because, you know, I mean, so they go to Sally Hemings and ask if she wants to go back to Africa, and she says no. She is listed there as a free Negro woman, I believe, that is the phrase that's used. She's no longer white at this point, but she uses this other, she is described in this other way, and they say she's freed in 1826. But there's no deed of emancipation for her. She's just let go, essentially, given her time is the phrase that they used, to stay in Charlottesville and be left alone. And as a law professor, this is really interesting to me. It's a very good illustration of the way the law actually operates. There's a statute that says, you know, if you're not formally freed, and you know, you if you don't have papers, freedom papers, you're not really free. But the community knows who she was, and they left her alone. So she lives out her life, and she dies in 1835, and Madison and Esten pick up and move to Ohio with their families later on. Esten, the youngest, after things begin to deteriorate in Ohio, moves to Madison, Wisconsin, and changes his name to E. Esten Hemings Jefferson, and he changes his racial designation to white. And after one generation, his grandchildren, great-grandchildren, don't know anything at all about their ancestors. Sally Hemings is erased from the story. Jefferson's, their Jefferson ancestor becomes an uncle of Jefferson, because he can't be Jefferson, because everybody knew that Jefferson had no legitimate sons. You couldn't have a last name Jefferson and come directly from Jefferson. So the family just goes into whiteness. And nobody knew of this connection until Fawn Brody, who wrote a biography of Jefferson in 1974, talked about, sort of included Madison Hemings' recollections, and talked about Esten and this family that lived on Staten Island, said, oh, these are our ancestors. They had, you know, their grandparents had tried to do genealogy and could not get back to a certain point, and they couldn't figure it out. And that's why they knew. That's how they knew what had happened, because Fawn Brody wrote this book. This was the family that gave the DNA that was tested in 1998 after I insisted in my first book that it was very likely that Jefferson and Hemings had had children together, and that the story about the Carr brothers, everybody tried to explain why Sally Hemings' children looked just like Jefferson, because they were the children of his nephew, Sam Carr, and the DNA exploded that story and found a connection between Jefferson and Hemings, and I was very relieved. very relieved that came that way. So this is, this family, I was at Monticello just this past weekend at something called a summit, the Summit on Slavery and the Legacies of Slavery. We had 2,100 people came up to the mountain on the West Lawn, black and white, you know, all, you know, races of people. Panelists, Henry Louis Gates, Marion Wright Edelman, you know, me and Peter, we were all there. Just a wonderful, wonderful moment. And I could only think of what Jefferson would have thought of all those people on his lawn, talking about the good parts of his vision and the bad parts of his vision, and saying that this was sort of the American story. Some people think he would have been aghast. I'm not so sure. It's not, I think Jefferson, one of the things that was clear to Peter and me as we were going through this, is that Jefferson was very much attuned to his time and attuned to the notion of the future. And I, maybe being Pollyanna-ish about this, or maybe too Jeffersonian in my optimism about this, that he would have thought it was a good thing. That through all of this struggle, through all of the terrible stories, that something good has come from all of this. And this is the way the Hemings descendants see it. This was not a pretty story, but something good has come from it. And that is what Jefferson contributes, that I don't think Hamilton does. I'm going to put this. That I don't think Hamilton does in the same way, because it's a story of America as the kind of society that Jefferson didn't believe could exist. It does exist. I mean, we're struggling with it, but a lot of it comes from his ideals. The Declaration, our creed, has made a lot of this possible. And so I like to think in the end that he would be happy about what we've done. Whether he would or not, his contribution, I really think, has made this possible. So with that, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for expanding our understanding of the American story through the stories that you've told through your books and here tonight. It's such an honor. Thank you all for being here tonight. If you would like to have your book signed, please meet Professor Gordon Reed in the room behind, and please come back again next year and get out to programs all around the state, all throughout the year. Thank you. Good night.